And as always, your views and comments are welcome. Look for us on our social media platforms, on Facebook at Join News, on Twitter at Join News on TV. Drop a comment and we'll be glad to share your thoughts with the rest of the world. You can send us a tweet with the hashtag #ThePulse. We'll be glad to retweet and also share your comments here on the show. My name is Francis Abba. Now we begin from Parliament, where as consultations begin for the consideration of a report recommending the amendment of the Constitution to change the date for the elections. Join News has picked up some credible information suggesting that the minority group in Parliament will vote against the proposal. At least 2/3 majority of all MPs present and voting is required to pass the amendment. This means the House needs more than just votes from the majority MPs. Their colleagues from the minority side will have to support them in getting it passed. Shortly, we'll speak to our parliamentary correspondent, Otun Bobe, who's been following development as regards this particular story and bring an update on what this will mean for the general picture of how things will look like for this year's elections. Already, you'll recall that at the consultative forum that happened about a week or two ago, concerns were raised specifically by the MPP about the November 7 date, the things that the EC needs to do ahead of that time, and whether or not they'll be able to finish it, considering that an amendment less than 6 months to a major election in the country could prove detrimental for the electoral process. We'll get to that in a moment and get to understand what is feeding the decision we are learning off of the minority to vote against the proposal to have the November 7 date approved by the House. Remember that for bills like this, it would require 2/3 majority in Parliament to have this passed. So even if, that is an if condition here, if the majority MPs are even to stand alone and say they would want to push this through, that will not represent 2/3 majority. They will necessarily need the take of some minority MPs to make up that 2/3 majority to take that decision. So we'll see how this plays out and what is feeding the minority's position on this matter. Is it the understanding that this could prove detrimental for the country? What reasons are they adducing for this? We'll come to that in just a moment and bring you some more details. Our parliamentary correspondent will join us here in the studio. He's been getting some more information from the House on this. But remember that today, these debates on this proposal should have happened today. But we're learning that the majority leader who was supposed to be in the House to ensure that this is done was not available. In fact, the communication to the Speaker was that he was unavailable. He was at a cabinet meeting, and that was one of the major reasons why this debate could not start, even though deliberations from yesterday with the Speaker indicated that this debate was central today, germane to the discussions. Nevertheless, other things took center stage today. In Parliament, the Abetifi MP, the new entrant, Mr. Brian Echampong, was sworn in. Also, the Matmo bill has come up for some stress scrutiny in the House. A lot of issues have been picked out on this matter. They are asking for some key decisions to be taken as regards this particular bill. The debate was hot and intense. We brought you live coverage of that debate here on your election headquarters on the Joy News channel on your multi TV. So in just a moment, Elton will join me. But this is also key because you're looking at the kind of consultations that have been done, the planning by the Electoral Commission. All the electoral activities have been tailored to meet the November 7 date. But as you can imagine, not everyone agrees with them that this decision will be taken in their best interest. And that is why we're beginning to see some kind of pushback in Parliament, especially from the minority MPs who believe that this decision will not be in their best interest. In fact, they also believe that this will not be in the interest of the Ghanaian populace. In just a moment, Elton will join me so we get to understand what is feeding this perception and what will happen tomorrow, in fact, when the debate starts. It was supposed to have been done today, but we're learning that because the majority leader, Alban Sumana Babin, was not in Parliament today because he was part of a cabinet meeting, that meeting, that debate will happen tomorrow. So we will bring you the details. But as I mentioned earlier, other issues took center stage in Parliament today. The new Abetifi MP, Brian Echampong, was sworn in. He was admonished by the Speaker to get to understand the standing orders to be able to do his job creditably in the one of the arms of government, the legislature, after taking over from the MP who passed about 2 months ago in that very sad incident. So Elton joins me now in the studio. He's our parliamentary correspondent, keeping tabs on this developing story of the minority pushing not to have this amendment done tomorrow. He joins me now in the studio. Good afternoon to you, Elton.
Good afternoon, Francis.
Right, so minority MPs blocking the amendment tomorrow. Why is this happening? What's the problem?
Well, that is information we've picked, that they may not support the amendment of the constitution to enable the EC hold elections in November instead of December. The information I'm picking from, I've been speaking to members on the minority side, they will not speak to me on record, but they are telling me that, I mean, that is the decision the caucus is taking. And indeed, this decision flows from a steering committee meeting held by the party last night, where it was agreed that the minority members should stay out of either approving the report for the amendment of the constitution so that the elections can be held in November. So going into the debates, obviously this is going to be the posture they will adopt
of the minority on this
side. They will express their concerns on the floor of parliament, and then when it gets to the voting parts,
they walk out.
They will not walk out. This is going to be a secret ballot. It's not going to be a head count or a voice vote. It's going to be a secret ballot. So I'm not even be surprised if some on the other side may decide to vote against, you know, the proposed amendment of the constitution. If that happens, then we're back to the status quo.
Okay, but is there a reason why this will be a secret ballot being done for this process?
Because we are amending the constitution. That is the process. Usually, if this was to be a vote for a motion or a bill, you are looking at a voice vote or a head count. Now, this is a voting to amend the constitution.
Okay, but also, I also want to understand one thing. For the minority, after this steering committee meeting and the decision taken, do we know what has influenced that decision? Is there a reason they feel that something needs to be done before?
For those who are seriously against the amendment of the constitution, they are of the view that we don't have so much time to get this particular this amendment through. And the position espoused by the Attorney General is that even those who are arguing that let's amend the constitution, but let's, with the caveat that it should take effect in 2020. We are told that once it is amended, it must take effect. So they are saying that we don't have enough time because the amendment will just be just one part of getting the process through. After the amendment, the Electoral Commission will have to come back to Parliament with a new CI, constitutional instrument, that will seek to give backing to hold the presidential elections in November. Now, the rule or the provision is such that for the parliamentary election, it should be held before the member of parliament goes, before the expired term of the member of parliament. That is in Article 112. Now, for the presidential election, it says that it should be done 4 months to the end of the year, of that particular year where we have an election. There's no definite date whether it should be done in November, October, or any. So, if they want to do it on November 7th to coincide with the holding of the parliamentary election, then there should be a CI. That CI will give backing or give the EC the opportunity to now hold the elections on November 7th, the presidential elections. Now, this will also require 21 days sitting of parliament before it can mature into law. Parliament will go on recess on the 29th of this month. They are not due back until October unless they are recalled under a certificate of agency for them to come and consider serious issues. So even the regulation that will seek to guide the election itself, it still has more days before it can mature. If they should go on the 29th, it will be left with about 5 or 6 days before that can mature. So the argument is that there isn't so much time for us to rush through things. Let's take our time. Let's look at 2020. So the Attorney General will, by all means, tomorrow move the motion for the second reading of the bill. The committee chair will present his report. It will be seconded by the minority with their own concerns with the bill. It will be up for the consideration of the House. Once that consideration is done, then we will move into the amendment or the consideration of the clause. This is just a one clause bill. So it's not supposed to take so much time. And then after the rule is that you have to wait for 48 hours before you can move the motion to the next stage. But they can overlook this particular provision and say that because of the tight schedule of what we are doing, let us go through with the process.
Okay.
And I'm telling you that the decision I'm picking from the minority is that they've been asked not to vote to amend the constitution for elections to be held in November.
Okay. But you see, I need to understand this. For the minority, even though the party has made it clear after the steering committee meeting that that is the position they should adopt tomorrow, will it be a surprise if tomorrow this decision is not carried through by all the minority MPs on this matter.
I can tell you for a fact that not every member in the minority is happy with the decision taken by the caucus. Indeed, there are some who have the view that they should support it. And I will not be surprised, because we are looking, we have 275 members of parliament. Yes. You need two-thirds majority. Two-thirds is about 183. None of the parties in parliament has that numbers to see this amendment through. They will require the support of each other. The NDC majority, they have the numbers in parliament, but it's not up to 183. You need about 40 members on the minority side to vote for to amend the constitution. And that is going to be a challenge they need to overcome.
Okay.
And judging from what I'm hearing, I'm looking at a proposed amendment on the floor that will be defeated. And we'll be going into holding the elections in December.
Okay.
I don't see anything changing from the position that I'm hearing the minority they've adopted.
Even though there are some dissenting voices in there.
There are those who are.
Those are
Francis, as a matter of fact, this is a secret ballot.
Mm-hmm.
So don't even be surprised if, even if they abstain from voting, you would find some members on the other side voting even against the proposed amendment.
Okay.
Because this is a secret ballot.
Mm-hmm.
Whichever way you vote, no one will know.
Okay.
It's like voting in the general elections.
All right. Mm-hmm. So today, we know the debate was actually supposed to have happened today.
Yeah.
It didn't take place.
It didn't take
We're learning that the majority leader was not in parliament, one of the key reasons for which it didn't happen.
As a matter of fact,
what was the problem?
The motion was supposed to be moved by the Attorney General and Minister of Justice. He was supposed to move it to second reading.
Mm-hmm.
She was in the house at the time business started. Now, along the line, she moved out of the chamber. Now, we were told that there was, you know, a cabinet meeting ongoing at a particular time. The majority leader was not in parliament at all. So, and the deputy majority leader, in his earlier statement, said that there are issues with the bill that they need to resolve with the house before they can bring it onto the floor. It was the minority leader who said that he spoke well, that the majority leader has been invited to a cabinet meeting. That's how come they were unable to move the motion. The majority leader was not going to play any role in the movement of the motion through second reading. The Attorney General was in the house. So, well, the cabinet issue will have to accept the explanation of the minority leader. But there may be issues that they need to resolve. They need to build consensus. They need to get this through.
Okay, so this will be interesting to look out for tomorrow when the debate begins and the whole process for the amendment begins in Parliament. Expect some drama to unfold based on what we are picking up today in Parliament tomorrow. But this is not the only thing that happened today in the House. And we know that the NAPMO bill came out for some consideration. There was a debate on it. What really happened in that regard?
Well, they started the debate last week. They are seeking to, you know, enhance the operations of NAPMO. That's what the bill is seeking to do. The only thing that stalled the debate today is this clause in the bill which says that 3% of the common fund to the district assembly should be dedicated to disaster management in the various districts. Some members of parliament are not happy, especially for those who rely solely on the, for the district who rely solely on the common fund for their activities. They are of the view that the 3% is on the high side. What about in the event that within the year they are unable to utilize the money for the purpose because there may be no disaster? How do we deal with this particular matter? So the speaker has asked for clarity on the 3% and whether it will vary from assembly to assembly, because some assemblies are big, they can stand on their own without support from the common fund. In the event that the administrator is unable to release a common fund and there's a disaster, how is the assembly going to deal with some of these things? So that is what stalled the debate on the NAPMO bill. They are going to do a win-win to, you know, resolve this particular issue.
What does the win-win mean?
Win-win means that the committee will now have to sit down with the members, take them through the clause one by one, try to come to a compromise on a particular clause, and then they'll come back to report that they've resolved the issue, they want to move the clause.
How long has such a process
taken? They can resolve it today, depending on when the committee will sit.
Okay, all right. What else happened in Parliament that we should be aware of today?
Well, for today, they are considering a number of bills. The Ghana Youth Commission bill is also one that they are considering. Friday, we've been told today that the finance minister will appear before the House to present a supplementary budget to Parliament. Now, the minority is pushing for the postponement of this presentation, because on Friday they are hoping to pay their last respect to the late member of parliament for Abetifi, Gafipipra. The body will be in parliament on Friday. They think that they will not have enough time to, you know, take this you know important subject of a supplementary budget. Also, they also consider the paying of their last respect to their colleague equally important. So the leadership will have to meet to, you know, come to a decision on when the finance minister can present the supplementary budget.
And parliament. Considering that we are going on recess on the 28th, it looks as though a lot of issues are before their table. They have to take one after the other. There are some concerns that during times like this, a lot of things can be pushed through with very little scrutiny.
Yes, it happens all the time, and especially the last days. I remember the last time, the last sitting before this one, we left the chamber around 12:30 midnight.
Mm-hmm.
And because they had to deal with all the matters that were in front of them. Even now we have a tall order. There are so many bills that they need to pass. There's the NADBO is one, the Ghana Aids Commission, even the EC's old regulation, the CI 794, must pass. And I'm saying that it will not pass if Parliament should go on recess on the 29th, because they will left with 6 more days for the team to
move. On that issue, is it possible that the Speaker can say, look, guys, you need to stay in and have this sorted out before you go?
Yeah, the Speaker has the ultimate responsibility to adjourn the House, so it is his word that will count. But MPs are pushing to go on the field to campaign for their re-election bid and for their presidential candidates. So we hope to see. But the point is that even if they should go on recess, the Speaker can record them anytime for them to see. Because without the regulation maturing, we cannot have an election
this year. Lots of pretty interesting times to look forward to in Parliament. But thank you, Otim Bobo. He's our parliamentary correspondent. He has his eyes and ears on every single issue that happens on the floor. We'll bring you more on the developments in Ghana's legislature in just a moment. We'll go for a quick break at this point. When we come back, there are lots of things happening at the Supreme Court in relation to the unanimous decision taken, ruling that the President is not bound by the advice given by the Judicial Council on the appointments of superior judges. We'll bring you that story after the short break. Stay with us.